Welcome, Black Cajun Sports presents National College Prep's first one-on-one conversation. And today, it is my privilege, my honor to welcome my little brother, my cousin. I think you guys are going to see it. I've been saying it for like 7 years. Nobody listens to me. When you look at me and then look at him, I think you can see it. This is my nephew, and he may be the best amateur basketball player in the Philadelphia region right now, Ryan Daly. How you doing, Ryan?
Sublime. It's enjoyable to know you in the concubines. Take off your coats.
Ladies, doing well, like doing well. Just hanging out, getting used to this virus going around, you know.
So how you making out during the stay home, stay sheltered in place thing? How you making out with that?
Yeah, you know, it's been tough, obviously. Can't watch any live games. Been watching games replays, YouTube videos. Shooting in the driveway, which I haven't really done, obviously, in a few years because I had St. Joe's in Delaware to shoot at, but using the basement, get push-ups, reps in like that, just trying to stay ready because hopefully this passes within the next few weeks, but obviously it could be longer, so I'm just going to try to stay ready for getting ready for next year already.
How y'all doing the academic stuff at St. Joe's? Everything's online now?
Yeah, so it was supposed to be everything online until April 9th, and then they actually just canceled that like 2 days ago, and everything's online for the rest of the semester. And then every class can be pass-fail now. So,
are you responsible enough to handle that, man?
Yeah, well, it was tough at first. Yeah, my parents are kind of staying on me for that, obviously. They're good with that, yeah. So, yeah, they won't let me slack off.
So, what are you doing to satisfy the competitive urge? Like, were you just beating up on Colin?
Yeah, we're just playing video games, and we're not. And we played Clue, this board game, and he beat me the last 2 days before this. And I won yesterday for the first time, and a lot of smack's been talked. But yeah, this is something crazy. Can't even play wiffle ball. Can't do anything. So we played horse yesterday. I beat my dad and Colin at horse yesterday. So.
Really?
Yeah.
Can your dad still shoot?
Yeah, his best chance is shooting with like his opposite hand and stuff like trick shots because he's not out shooting me or Colin right now.
All right, let's get to the real questions, the stuff I know people want to know. This is a like you just mentioned, this is a real crazy off season. Everything is thrown out of whack. The poor high school kids, they don't have AAU. I don't know if they'll have that June live period for high schools was actually pretty good last year.
Yeah,
I don't know if they'll be able to have that by June. Everybody's thrown off, but for guys such as yourself, maybe Colin Gillespie, maybe Zane Martin, you guys as juniors, you added some interesting stuff to think about in the summer, you know. I guess I have to ask people, are you going to play college basketball next year?
That's my, obviously there's the NBA draft is, they've made it easier for people to enter, and I haven't made a decision either way if I plan on putting my name in. I've been having conversations with Coach Lang and my parents. It's a fluid situation. I'm just taking it day by day. Obviously that's something that's on the back burner of everyone's minds with the NBA just being shut down. The draft is probably the least of their worries, but I have been having talks with my parents about that. I'm not decided either way on what I plan to do, if I'm going to even put my name in there, but with the new rules it could make sense, but I'm not sure yet what I'm doing.
In a perfect world, how would it work? You would put your name in and then they would evaluate you, or you get to go somewhere and get evaluated?
Yeah, so I think during talks during the year with Coach, he maybe had thought of possible plans for me after this year if I was going to do that. I think there's a form that you submit to a committee displaying your interest, and they send feedback back. And I think over that time, they would tell you if you're first round, second round undrafted type thing. And then teams would bring you in for workouts, 3-on-3, like small 6-man workouts and 1-on-1 workouts if they were really interested. So I think that would be the I knew Charlie went through that last year, but obviously now everything's shut down, so I don't really know what the process would be if I decided to put my name in.
I like your chances in those kind of settings, especially against, you seem to have a thing for guys from big programs, big schools. You seem to like to give those guys 30, 35.
That's right, the bigger dogs,
So I would recommend that they put you in with somebody, I don't know, from Duke, Arizona, Kansas, and I like your chances in that, man. Look, you got 1,600 plus right now with another year left. You averaged 20 this year, 7 rebounds, and over 4 assists. Now, beginning of the year, before the season started, I put up a post and I said, I want 25 and 5. And you were like, that's doable.
Yeah.
I mean, do you think, given you, who the biggest programs you players played this year? UConn,
Villanova, Dayton, Florida. Yeah.
You did well each and every one of those games.
Yeah. I scored pretty well in those games.
So, how you think you match up against guys as far as going to the next level, sneaking in the NBA or playing in the G League and getting in the NBA? You know, a lot of our guys have to go that route because it's only 2 rounds.
Yeah. I like my chances. You know, I'm a competitor. I don't really know if there's anyone more competitive than me in the country. I personally believe I'll rip your throat out to win. Obviously, there's more athletic guys, but I mean, production sometimes has to hopefully outweigh potential, you know, and I kind of have produced since I was a senior in high school on every level. I'm just trying to show that. So I think if I do get that chance, I mean, I like my chance. Obviously, I can't jump as high as those guys, but I mean, competitive.
So what are you? What are you? You a 1, 2, 3 basketball player?
I think I'm a basketball player. That's a great way to put it. I think obviously I would probably be a combo. I think this year I showed that I could play make more than I had before. More I was a scorer at Delaware those 2 years. I think this year the ball was in my hands so much that I had to make reads and plays. And, you know, 4.5 assists a game. Truthfully, and we didn't really shoot as well as a team as we thought we would have. So I think they could have been up. I mean, I didn't make as many shots, and we didn't really make many shots this year as a team. So I think that could have gone up. But I think I demonstrated that I can handle the ball a little bit. So in a situation if I needed to handle the ball, I could be a combo. But, yeah, just a basketball player.
Individually, and I've been following St. Joe's closely since Mo Martin, Jeff, and Wayne came in 82, fall of 82. Individually, you just put up one of the best statistical years all the time I followed. Marvin's junior year was pretty spectacular. Yeah. Jameer's senior year. It's pretty spectacular. Mo Martin, I mean, he was a lottery pick, but his statistically, it wasn't like what you put up. You actually had more points, rebounds, and assists than Langston or Charlie in their best years. So how do you keep at it? How do you keep yourself motivated once it became apparent that league title, NIT, NCAA, postseason was off the table? How do you stay motivated?
Well, I had a lot of people who believed in me. If I gave up and was just playing not to win, I mean, that would be a disservice to everyone who helped me get here, my parents. I mean, people have gone fight. I mean, when I was a senior, you know, I was passed over by everyone. There were people who fought to the nail to try to get me to a Division I school, and obviously my story is a little up, like, windy, but I mean, if I ever gave up, that'd be disrespectful to everyone who believes in me. So I was just playing for, and I love St. Joe's. Obviously, the circumstances were different when I committed, but I still love St. Joe, and I still love Billy just as much.
Every night before the game, it's a game tomorrow. We getting on a bus, we getting on a plane, we getting on whatever. You think you winning the game?
Yeah, no, never had a doubt in my mind we're gonna win.
No matter what the record is.
Nah, that didn't. Florida Nova, Dayton Nova.
That's impressive, brother. I like that. I like that. Look, a St. Joe's fan hit me up on the internet, and he wanted to know your perspective on your redshirt year. Did that help you? You know, one, did you think you would get a waiver? Did you try with a waiver? Did it come through? Did practicing against, who you probably matched up with, Charlie?
Yeah, Charlie.
So that was a year.
Yeah.
Charlie, I know there are times when I watch Charlie, and he does things, and he does them so easily and so effortlessly. Yeah. He don't realize how hard some, like, the left-handed shots. People don't do that stuff.
Yeah.
So how was your year in between Delaware and St.
So I left Delaware due to personal reasons. It wasn't basketball related. I wasn't myself. I battled some stuff that I didn't want to go through, and I needed to be closer to home. Family reasons, I had to be. I just wasn't happy. Couldn't even – yeah, it was bad. So I came to St. Joe's. I wasn't planning on applying for a waiver. I was just content with being here. I was home. Yeah, and then I think during the fall, people were getting waivers left and right, and I was like, me and Phil were kind of like, Coach Phil was like, let's try it. Like, it can't hurt. So we sent our appeal in. The NCAA came back and said, if maybe like 3 weeks before the season, if you guys get this other thing for my, because I was going to, I saw when I was transferred to Delaware, I saw a therapist, and they basically were like, if you could get this in wording, we're going to rule you eligible. Unfortunately, it didn't cooperate as well as we thought. I found out the day of Monmouth that I wouldn't be up the first game.
It's no rhyme or reason to it, man. Quade Green goes from Kentucky
to Washington.
As far, I mean, unless you play in Alaska,
yeah,
I mean, that's as far as you could possibly go.
Yeah.
He gets a waiver and plays right away.
There was no really reason they gave me. I found out the day of the first game, the morning of the first game, that I wasn't going to be eligible against Monmouth. And I never really got my hopes up too much because I wanted to say even. It would have been awesome. I think the year would have probably gone a little differently.
So basketball-wise, how did it work out? I mean, every day of practice, would you be lifting, running? What were you
doing? So my schedule, usually the red shirts, they would lift the day of the games. Mine would be more condition-based because I think I'm already strong enough. So we would do like the versus climber, but during practice I would always be the other team's like league best scorer, guy. Best guy, face.
Were you giving it to him?
Yeah, we were giving it to him. yeah, we were. You can ask Charlie Fresh; they'll tell you. I was cooking them last year. But yeah, so that retro year was great for me to sit out and just be happy. I mean, I love St. Joe's. I met great friends. Got close to my teammates, obviously. The year we were projected second, we didn't finish there, which was tough. And to sit out as a competitor, I think we probably would have been a little bit better if I had been able to play. I think me, Charlie, Jared, and Fresh would have been a handful to deal with offensively. But, yeah, it's tough.
What when you were playing Charlie every day, did it seem like – did you think he could play in the NBA?
Yeah, I thought Charlie, when I first came in the summer – He was shooting like left hand threes like just easily, like, and like it was weird, but like he could do it, so like no one really said anything. And then during the start of the year, when he had 37 against William and Mary, all like efficient, just pro type easy moves. I thought he was going to be a pro, and you know he is a pro, and it was great to go against him because I think what I have in terms of just like strength and aggression, he's far, like long skilled, like we're different, and I think that was good to go against each other because I think there's two different sides of the ability to score the ball. So I think that was it was really good for both of us.
So seeing him have that kind of really success, because you know a lot of people doubted Charlie. I thought he'd squeeze in there one way or another, and he managed to play you know 10-12 games in the league this year,
and he
had a great G League season. Did that give you confidence knowing that you really competed, you know, equally with him at practice every day?
Yeah. I think seeing him, obviously St. Joe's for a small school has had a number of pro, probably the most amount of pros in the Atlantic 10 success-wise, Jameer, Delonte, Dwayne Jones, Langston, Bembry, now Charlie. That's like, for a school this size, it's unheard of really. So I think seeing that, yeah, Charlie, I mean, he was my roommate last year.
I'm counting it up, man. We there? Yeah. You know, I go to NBA games when y'all play.
Yeah.
Langston, he played in that G League, man. I would talk to him all the time. He's like, come on up. Yeah. Ah, man, yeah. G League. As soon as he got to the league, though.
Yeah, so that's my goal. I think it's a possibility.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
It's got to be the right fit, right GM, right coach that appreciates what you bring.
Yep.
That's it. Mm-hmm. Look, your grandfather, he played at St. Joe's, and he coached some really good teams. That 86 team was really good. Your dad played at St. Joe's, and he was a high school coach, had some success, was a really good a coach on a really good Boston University team. He helped Pat Chambers and them turn the corner. Your grandma went to St. Joe's. Your mom went to St. Joe's. Some aunts and uncles went to St. Joe's?
Yeah, my uncle Jim, he was the Hawk. Toe Boyle, he's a director of scouting. Then he was a manager there.
Your sister's
home? My sister, yeah, at St. Joe's, through and through.
So what does it mean for you to, you know, put that jersey on 30 times and get out there?
It means the world.
Yeah, it means the world. Obviously, I grew up on St. Joe's, going to games. I was at the Gonzaga, St. Joe's game when Gonzaga came. I remember, I don't know what year it was.
That was Jameer and him.
Austin Day, he was there, and then I was there when McDermott came. I was there when St. Joe's beat Nova by 20, and Aiken and Ronald Roberts were just dunking everything. So I remember all those games. I have a Jameer jersey in my room. I have the Sports Illustrated cover. I'm St. Joe's, so it means the world to be here, playing for St. Joe's. I love the place. I love the way it's been the best 2 years of my life so far, in terms of how happy I've been. And I love it. So it's been the best thing ever for me.
You know, all we got to do is win some games, man.
We'll get that.
You got the rest of it.
I mean,
you look like me, so you're a nice looking kid, right? You got that going for you. You're not a big old 7 foot guy. You kind of normal sized, and you're putting up incredible numbers. We're talking legendary stuff.
Yeah, we'll see. I think we're going to turn the right corner with these transfers and freshmen. I think we're going to be all right.
All right, well, let's talk about that. Coach Lang, he inherited a really tough situation, having to come behind Phil Martelli, and everybody, you know, really liked Phil. Phil's a kind of a basketball icon here in Philadelphia. And then on top of that, several of the key players, Charlie decides to go pro. Fresh decides to go semi-pro to Louisville. A couple of the recruits backed out, changed their mind. And as a result, the team had to really rely on you for a lot. Now, before the season, like I said, I said I expected 25-5. You pretty easily met those goals and exceeded them. Did you expect to have such a productive year in the A-10, and how much different is playing in the A-10 versus the competition and the level of athleticism and all that stuff in the CAA?
Yeah, it's a good question. Obviously, we lost Jared and Fresh, Jameer Jr., Bones, probably, from what I've heard, Hakeem Hart. Yeah, so we lost that, you know, and then I think there was one point it was only me, Longpre, and Taylor were on the team. Lorenzo was still in the portal. So we really, like, at this time last year, there were three Hawks on the roster. So Coach had fill a roster full of eight scholarships. And especially with the backlash that was faced nationally. I mean, there's ESPN segments about how it was handled. That's another story. But we had talks early on that he was probably going to help rely on me a little bit. I would never be surprised that I averaged I've been kind of trying to produce for a while now. But I think it was like a shot. You know, it's different when you're at St. Joe. It's like a different. I mean, the CAA.
Our guy's much bigger, much faster. About the same.
I would say like the average like size of the position is like increased by like an inch and a half maybe in the athleticism. You know, Justin Ray Foreman from Hofstra. Brantley and Chile. I played three guys in the NBA, in the CAA, and Riller from Charleston's Virginia drafted this year, and Nathan Knight probably will from William Mary. So, you know, they're pros there, and they're good. But then, I mean, we had the best player in the country this year in the A-10. They were going to be a number one seed. So that's what you don't get in the CAA, and you don't get kids like Fats, and like they're common in A-10, you know. Even VCU was preseason top 25. They finished 8th or 9th in the 8th. Davidson, both those two have both NBA level talent at some positions, and you know they finished 7th and 8th. And in a league like the A-10, you can't really take any games off. There's no easy wins. So that's what I learned. But yeah, it's a step up in competition for sure. But the CAA is definitely a good league with great guards.
You mentioned that you took kind of a winding route to get to your dream school.
Yeah.
And I was in touch with you and your dad during your recruitment process. It was a real head scratcher for me. I couldn't, we couldn't figure it out.
Yeah.
You had the grades. You had a strong SAT score. I mean, you were Ivy and Patriot qualified,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
I mean, we didn't have those issues, right? That wasn't the issue.
Yeah.
You were the Catholic League MVP, yet you were passed over by every City 6 school.
Yeah.
Same thing. We just mentioned Brickus in passing. You know, he's gone through it. Same thing kind of happened to Zane. Same thing kind of happened to Sharkey. All of you guys have proven, with the exception of Brickus, and I'd bet on it, that he'll be a really good college player. But all of you guys have proven to be really exceptional Division I basketball players. I want your take on it. Why are the local kids evaluated so harshly by the local coaches? Like, why don't they see in you guys some of the stuff they see in the guys they bring in from out of town? Because you're better than a lot of the guys they bring in.
Me, Zane, and Sharkey. Yes. I'd like to find three guys. Yeah, that's a great question. I think, obviously, for each case it varies. You know, Sharkey, everyone said he was too small, but, you know, he's the best on-ball defender
in the country.
Yeah, and probably one of the best passers in the country.
For a while, he was leading the nation.
In steals and his steals. Yep. I tried. I preached Sharkey as much as I could. Zane, that's a head scratcher, too. You know, he's athletic. He can score the ball easily.
Shoot.
Yeah. And he had 1,000 almost. Close to 1,000 in 2 years. Dude. At 1,000. And then me, you know, tweener. Because I rebound like a big man. I guess they thought I was an undersized 4. Not that athletic, but I think we're all basketball players, and I think, there's kids in this area that, like, should be recruited. I mean, kids want to stay home.
So what do you think? You know what I hear? This is one of the theories I hear, that they see you guys so much, and that the little flaws that you just, or the perceived flaws that you just pointed out, that they get magnified in these guys' eyes.
Yeah.
You know, it's just like, oh, he can't do this. So you see him so much, you focus on what he can't do. You go to a high school live period, or you go to an AAU game. Guy makes 5 threes in a row. Oh, I love him.
Yeah, he's the best.
And you are.
I've seen.
Is it a little bit of that? Is it just the familiarity just breeds?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, and I think there's probably, in the coach's mind, that, you know, obviously if you're a local kid, you have this is from, obviously I've been around coaching my whole life, and so I'm thinking more like, but if you bring in a Philly kid, hit their pressure of keeping the AAU and his corner, you know, that corner happy. I think that's something that people have to think about, instead of just looking at the actual player. You know, they don't want to treat a Philly kid wrong, or, you know, ruin a relationship with a high school or AAU program because they didn't do their player justice with playing time or anything like that.
Don't you think that by passing the kids over, did you have the same kind of?
No, that's true. That's the same thing, obviously. You know, you passed every school. I mean, Coach, he passed on me. Temple, Drexel, LaSalle.
When he came back after his sophomore year at Delaware, did you mention that to him?
Nah, I wasn't mentioning that. It was all good. He wasn't the if he was the only one, then I would have. But he wasn't the only. There was. My mom's got all the receipts of what Coach just said. She's keeping them all in her head. So one day my mom will go off about it. We'll see. I don't know.
We don't want your mom going off about it. No, we don't want that. But I actually was talking to Sam Sessoms.
He's another one.
Last week.
Yeah, he's another one. Yeah, he's definitely
one offer.
Yeah.
One. He had Binghamton. He's like, yo, I'm going to Binghamton. They offered me. I remember you were actually thinking about considering. People not gonna believe this. Walking on at an America East school.
Yeah, just school.
Yeah, just because I blew my ankles.
Walking on at an American East school 36 months ago.
Yeah, in Connecticut too. Not even close to
that. Exactly 25 minutes ago, we were talking about NBA.
Yep, it's been quite a road. Yeah, it's crazy. And Sessom's another one. I didn't even mention him.
This is what I'm talking about. And we had Ivy League schools that were flirting hard and then didn't want to go to the prom with you at the end of the day.
My whole AU team had Patriot League offers. I never won. My whole team went at Patriot League. I never won.
Jersey Shore?
Yeah. And Kyle Stout, Sam Iorio, Saeed Nelson, Pat Andre, Tommy Funk, everyone. Yeah, he's awesome. He's my guy. Yeah, he did, so.
All right, so we still, it's a mystery to us. We can't figure it out. All right, one of the St. Joe's guys on a message board, he wants me to ask you, how does Foster, Bishop, and Jansen look in practice, and do you see them, you know, fitting in next year, understanding the way you guys are playing and want to play, and helping the team?
Yeah, so I'll go individually, I guess. Foster's really, really athletic.
What is he, a one?
He's a one. Yeah, he's a one. Probably the best on-ball defender we'll have next year. He guarded me every day in practice last year. I think I made him better. He made me better because he's got pro athleticism. Off 2 feet, he's a rocket. He's I would say he's definitely more like a slasher, like getting to the basket. But he can also, he's been working on his three a lot during his redshirt year, so he'll be able to help.
If you're going to play for Billy Lang, you better work on your, or you're going to have to sit down.
He's going to be really good for us because he's calm, relaxed, and he's been there. I mean, he was at Gonzaga when they went to the Elite Eight or Final Four, they did, so he'll help. Bishop, another freak athlete, you know, he was close to top 100 if he wasn't. It was good to get him to come home. He can score the ball really well.
Is he making that jump shot? It's streaky.
It's streaky. Yeah, it's streaky.
I seen him hit a bunch in a row. Then I seen him miss a bunch in a row.
He
got a little side spin or something.
Yeah. I think they're
straighten it out for him.
I'll try. Listen, he's a great kid. He's always in the gym. His locker's right next to mine. I think he kind of like tries to poke my brain because I think like maybe he went to Xavier and it didn't go as planned. Obviously, with his playing, so he's always asking questions and stuff like that. Him and Ramir are really good with that, like trying to get better. I think he's going to be pretty good, you know.
Quietly, he is a Delco kid.
I said that, right? I
he
heard
played for the Darby Township Eagles. Yeah.
I'd say he's Delco. He claims West Philly. But
see, he claims West Philly with his athleticism and his athletic upbringing occurred in Darby Township.
I told him that.
But he's a great kid. And then Jansen, Anton, he's a legit 6'10 and a half, 6'11. He's big. He's opposite of what you'd think of a European. So he's not really a great shooter from three, but he is strong as an ox. He goes after every rebound. He'll throw his elbow, hit you in the face. He almost gave me a concussion before the Rhode Island game, hedging a ball screen. And we almost had to fight right then and there because if I got hurt on a practice play, I would have probably punched him. But he's physical. He doesn't care. he rebounds well. He's a great kid. You know, he's still getting adjusted to the speed of American game.
Where is he from?
Sweden.
They speak English, right?
No, he didn't speak. He speaks a little bit of English. It's getting better. Yeah, he speaks English, but he's got a thick accent. But, yeah, I think all three of them obviously will help. And then Jordan Hall, we're hoping.
he facilitates.
He's a great passer. He's
so big.
Yeah, he's like a legit 6'8", 6'7". Yeah, he's like a Swiss Army knife.
He can do it with his left hand.
Yeah, I watched a few of his games, and yes. I'm excited to play with him. We didn't really get many open looks this year. If we didn't really have the people to get in the paint, but I think with these guys, that'll really help.
I watched a lot of your games. You had a real good understanding of catching the, especially zones, out of place and using skip passes to get assists. Jordan does.
That, yes.
Yes. Well, yeah, he can see. Yeah. So you might be able to spot up and get on the receiver. You had to do everything off the dribble this year, man.
Yeah, everything was actual coverage.
Dude, I used to tell your dad, I said, you know, Ryan leads the nation in falling down, man.
That's why I hurt my knee. I have like a sack full of blood still attached to my knee because I fell on my right knee so often.
Your dad and I actually had a conversation. He was a little afraid because the bleachers are kind of close at St. Joe's, and you just fall. Stop falling, man.
Listen, stop falling, man.
All right. Another thing people want to know. That crazy ass shot you made.
Yeah, that was the three pointer.
Yeah, I was at Wawa last night, and the worker was like, "Oh, I saw you on SportsCenter," and I was like, "Oh, what? From like January? I think it was like January 11th."
Wait a minute. It's off the wrong foot or one of your right foot, right hand.
Yeah.
Catch it, flip it up.
Yeah, that was.
I don't know. That was my football. I like football more than I like basketball. Truthfully,
you were conscious of the line.
I wasn't. I knew I was behind the line with my right foot, but I wasn't sure if my left foot had touched before my. So if I was like straddling it and just flicked it, but when I saw the replay, I was pretty sure I got it. That was wild. Yeah, that was cool.
You were conscious of the clock.
I was screaming at Miles to throw that back because I was screaming at him, and he just did. Truthfully, probably was a better pass to Lorenzo, but I kind of just like reached back. Put my left hand on it for a split second just to like gather and just flicked it, and then it went in. Coach Lang had walked to the lot, like he thought it was done. You know, everyone kind of thought it was done. Yeah, it was wild.
Yo, man, come on, man. All right, I could see you playing NBA, Euro. I don't know, until at least 37, 38 years old. I think you just until your body falls apart. That's what I anticipate. So then what happens? What you doing at that point? You selling insurance, man? You working in a flower shop? No. What you doing?
Yeah, working in my mom's flower shop. No, I'm not doing that. I probably obviously want to do something with basketball. Maybe college coach would be really appealing, you know, grow up around it. Now, I don't know if I want to deal with kids like myself, not going to class and stuff like that sometimes, but I'm just joking. But, yeah, I probably want to do work, either be a college coach somewhere.
Well, people don't know this. People don't know you got this side, man. Like, you like to live, you know. You have a good time with this college thing, man.
Yeah.
And you know who else did? Jaquan Newton did. And people would say to me, you know, Jaquan, he didn't have success or he was a failure. I'm like, Jaquan scored over 1,000 points in the ACC.
Yeah,
went to the NCAAs like 3 out of 4 years.
Sixth man of the year, I think
he had a good time.
Yeah.
You know, you're enjoying your college experience. So if you're a college coach and you walk in, and you see Ryan Daly, your first reaction is what?
If he competes like I'm taking him right away. For me, Sesums, Gillespie, Sharkey, Zane, that's what I would be in it for those type of kids. But that's what I want to do probably, or maybe work in the front office of an NBA. That'd be a goal. Obviously, if I could get to the NBA playing wise, I think that would really help my chances post playing. But yeah, one of those two things I would, or I could see myself as like a working on like maybe like a network as like an analyst or something, like not like consistently, but like maybe like fill-ins. You know, I've seen people do that. Like maybe obviously there's no A10 network, that would be pretty good, but just trying to do something definitely involved in sports. I can't see myself doing my mom's flower shop or That's not me. So
you're going the insurance route, man.
Nah, I'm not working for Blue Cross either. I'm gonna try to do something with basketball as much as I can.
So you want to coach St. Joe's, man?
I love St. Joe's. So if I could stay around St. Joe's as long as I could, that'd be awesome. This place
that sounds like a job interview.
This place is home to me.
Sounds like a job interview.
Yeah, this place is home to me. So I'll do anything for St. Joe's. So if they call, I'm definitely answering.
All right. Now there's a lot of kids right now, like we talked about, you know, and I'm actually getting calls from kids and even more so from the parents that are just
worried.
Yeah, because they don't have a chance to prove themselves.
Yeah.
So this recruitment thing is going to really be rough. Like you said, the seniors that have already exhausted and haven't committed, the rising juniors, the prep school guys, if you haven't signed on a dotted line and taken a scholarship.
Yeah, it's going to be tough.
So given that you held out, you held out a long time, man. I mean, UMBC came kind of hard, right?
Yeah, I played my April life period, and I ended up getting like UMBC, Mount St. Mary's when Jamie Allen was there.
And I was a little, I was like, man, take that shit. Take that. Yeah. And you were like,
wait to see what happened.
So talk to the, how do you balance that out? How do you know when, you know, hey, maybe I'm pushing my luck or.
Yeah. So I see kids all the time, kind of, I can think of a few examples. I won't name that they think they've been told or they think they are higher level than they actually are. And that's what you got to be careful of, because those spots will fill up quick. They're not waiting. In a heartbeat. They're not waiting. If they ask you to commit then and there, and you say I'm not ready, you know they're gonna. Luckily for me, I hadn't been in a situation. I didn't have enough offers where I was like, oh, I want to go here. And Penn, there was something that went down, but I wasn't fully sold on Penn. But that's a different story. But I waited till May.
Is that why you did that to him this year, man?
Yo,
I watched them highlights like 12 times. I was like, this is personal.
The
honesty is appreciated. You only get it here. Alright, so why accept it as soon as Inglesby calls?
So yeah, I was May, I think 25th maybe, like I was done classes in high school. You know, it's not often that you probably see a Catholic League player that you're not have a place where he was comfortable. Or I liked UMBC, I liked Mount St. Mary's, but
I visited both of them.
That brand new gym was open?
No, they had not opened. That brand new gym
was open.
I heard it's really nice.
Oh man, yeah, I didn't know. I was just there for a high school game. It was like IMG, Oak Hill, St. Francis.
I heard it's pretty nice, yeah.
Spectacular. And that coach,
he's a great dude. They came.
It was him?
Odom, yeah. So Odom had taken the job, and he came to Carroll to visit me. I probably would have, if I wasn't so set on Delaware, you know, I mean, or Drexel, I was thinking about.
Odom's recruiting you, Delaware is not filled.
Yeah, because that was the last job filled. So that was always in the back of my mind. You know, there had been.
Who's going to get
this? Yeah, I'd heard like the dude Peggy's from Xavier, wherever he was at, Coach Inglesby and a few others. And I was just holding out hope for that. And then when he got the job, he's a Cal guy. I was confident he had a great relationship with my Tony Sigona, because Vistoria and Notre Dame guys, and then he played with Coach Paul. So when that happened, that was unbelievable. You know, that was that felt like all everything I went through was worth it for that, because I was really excited about that opportunity.
So he calls you, he offers you what happened?
Right away. I said yes, right away. I never been to the school.
No, I got a talk to my mom.
No, I was in my room. I got a call from a South Bend number. He said, hey, what's up? And I was like, and he said, like, I'm going to offer you. I said, right away, yep, I'll be there. either summer session, I'll be there. I came out there. They were cooking dinner, I think, or maybe playing a game. And I was like, yeah, I just came to Delaware. Like, I didn't consult them. They knew if I got that, I was going. I just did it. I wasn't messing around.
This is the second time in a week a kid's told me he's done that. People have this impression that, like, handlers – and dads and moms run this. You said, I'm going. Yeah. And then you told your parents. Yeah. Sam Sessom said the exact same thing. He said, I told Dempsey I was coming to Binghamton. Then I called my father and said, yo, I keep telling y'all, these kids have their own opinions, their own lives, their own ideas.
I wasn't risking that. I wasn't doing it. I mean, they were obviously supportive of Delaware and Coach Martin, but
you hadn't visited or anything?
I had never been to the campus, not once. Didn't know what I was major. I didn't know anything. I was going. I waited too long to not pass up on a good CAA school close to home.
It was a pleasant surprise to see those facilities down there, wasn't it?
Yeah, that place is hidden, a sleeping giant, and they're gonna be. I think they're gonna win the league next year. They got everyone back.
I came down before you played a game. I went to a practice, and I had interviewed Inglesby, and off the record, I was like, "So how's he doing?" You know, he said, "Well, yeah, he's gonna play." He said, "You know, our kids play pickup, and you know they figure it out." He said, "But Ryan's the first person chosen every game."
Yeah.
I said, really? I said, over the seniors, the upper guy, he said, Ryan's the first guy. So you went down there giving it out.
Yeah, I would say the first practice in summer, it was like an open gym. And I kind of was matched up against the two-guard that was coming back, started on pace for 1,000 points. And I wasn't scared. And I had ripped him a few times and like finished. And I think that they kind of just slowly built up. And then in the fall I was playing pretty well, you know.
Then you came to LaSalle.
Yeah, my first two games I had like 2 points, 4 points, and then LaSalle, like, I kind of had I had almost 20 or something.
Your dad texts me. He says, your boy had, I forget what it was, 20 something. I'm like, who? I didn't know who he was talking about. And it was on. I have watched every single box score since that day.
It's been a fun ride, man.
Yeah. All right. So, I got one last question. Since you say you playing horse and all that, is Colin's jumper still wetter than yours, man?
He thinks so. Standstill, I'll give him. He's knocked. No. But in terms of overall jumper, no. Off the dribbles, feet away.
Just standstill, he'll knock it down on.
Probably. He's probably got that. I got to give him that. He shot like 46%. Yeah, no, to me. But he shot like 46 from three this year, so I got to give him that.
They had a good year. Did you follow them?
Yeah, I did.
They were wrong. What happened?
I don't know. I couldn't tell you. They had a lot of talent, you know. They lost some the year before, and I think they weren't anticipating the success they were having early on, and then I guess they got used to it or something. But Robbie, he's a great player. Malik Jackson's a Delco kid. He's pretty good too.
Big Marcus, if they get him, you know, committed, get it all together.
Yeah, that's a steal for that level.
They just picked up Manigo from
McDevitt. I saw that. Yeah, and I
got it going on.
Yeah, that was it was fun to watch. Those playoff games are pretty intense. I mean, I went to their playoff game when they played where's Cerruti? Lockhaven? Yeah, Cerruti, Jesse McPherson, the kid from Carroll. I went to that game. It's high level basketball. I mean, those kids, Cerruti, you can put Cerruti in the A-10, and they'll do just fine. Robbie Heath can play in the A-10. Obviously, he's got some suitors.
Does he have A-10 schools?
I don't really know. Him and my brother talk about that often. I saw him at the mall, I think, and he was told me he was thinking about it, but he obviously hadn't reached out to any school. He wasn't doing anything shadily. But he kind of just asked me, like, the process I went through, because, you know, when you're considered when you're the leading scorer, one of the main guys, and you enter.
I thought you were quick with the high school stuff with Delaware, and you were quick with St. Joe's. Like, you knew where you wanted to go.
I knew. Like, you know, I think if I was going to go far, I would have probably gone. I think Xavier was my best offer, and I really liked them. But I was set on coming home.
How many calls did you get when you went to Portland?
30, 40? Yeah, I probably had like 30 or 40 calls within. And I actually, like, the A-10 tournament, or the, it was still like the Sweet 16 round when I committed to St. Joe's. Like, I committed real. Like, I probably had 30 for ACC, Big East, SEC.
24 months before that, you were thinking about walking on in American East.
It's been a wild ride. I'm not slowing down.
Sam Sessoms has over 50 offers.
He's
Arkansas.
Yeah.
Penn State.
Yeah.
Marquette. Clemson.
I don't blame him. He
24 months ago, I'm talking to his dad like I talked to your dad. Nothing. Trying to get.
That's why Gillespie, I mean, I
was talking to Colin during his whole.
Yeah.
Actually, I visited. John had me come up and talk to his team. And I had a Ryder hoodie on. And Colin had like fucking Albany or somebody like that, right? So I said, Albany? So I said I said, you like these guys? He said, yeah. So I said, oh, they'll offer you tomorrow. I'll tell them to offer you.
He's the goods, yeah.
Did the same thing at Delaware. Did the same thing at Drexel. I was like, why you guys? This kid's good.
Yeah.
About a week later, Jay and Ashley came and shut that. They shut that stuff down. Well, look, man, we really appreciate this. I think the city needs to get to see this side of you. I'll tell you, if y'all see him at night down Manioca South Street, he's a different Colin than he is on that basketball court. But Ryan Daly, again, may be the best basketball player in Philadelphia, this side of the Philadelphia 76ers. And if we could just win some games next year, I don't think there'll be any doubt about it, man. You feel comfortable?
Yeah.
If we don't add nothing else, you like the guys you're going to war with next year?
I'm confident.
There you have it, people. From the Daily Resident, Black TV Sports.
Let me take it to the Queen side. I'm taking it to Brooklyn side. All the residential questions who invade the air. Hold up a second, son, cause we almost there. You could be a black man and lose all your soul. You could be white and blue, but don't prep the road. See, my feet is universal if you got knowledge of Dolo or Delph or Self. See, there's no one else who could drop it on the angle. Acute at that. So, who that, do that, do that, that, that.
Come on.
Who that, do that, do that, that, that.
Yeah.
Do that, do that, do that, that, that. I'm bugging out, but let me get back cause I'm wet. So run and tell the others cause we are the brothers. I learned how to build bikes in my workshop class. So give me the sword and let's not make it the last.